Hearty welcome to all of you. It's a lovely morning. Summer is setting in, and I think this is the right time to start dreaming big also. Let me quickly give you a little difference between these various things that happen, you know. One is the actual dreams that you get when you are sleeping. Now, a lot of research, a lot of work has been done on it. We have what is called the REM sleep and the non-REM sleep. REM sleep is where you have a rapid eye movement. If you see a person sleeping and you go close, even though his eyelids are closed, behind the eyelids, you will see some slight movement of the pupils. That is what is called as REM sleep. That means the eyelids are moving, and it's an indicator that the person is dreaming. We all go through this, you know, alternation between REM sleep and non-REM sleep. When we are having the REM sleep, we are dreaming. When we are having non-REM sleep, we are going into a blank phase. Everybody dreams, remember that. Some people remember their dreams, some people don't remember their dreams. You know what it depends on? It depends on when you wake up. So, if you wake up during the REM sleep, you immediately recall that, yes, I was dreaming this. When you wake up in the non-REM phase, you don't remember. You say, no, I slept soundly. I don't think I had any dreams. You did have, but you didn't remember them. The only exception is what we call as nightmares. Some dreams which are so disturbing that they disrupt your sleep and you wake up. The mind revolts when such a, you know, horrifying or such a bad to the thoughts are coming in your dreams, the mind revolts and wakes you up so that that nightmare ends. Other than that, we have this REM sleep, non-REM sleep. And while dreams are not in our control, they are definitely an indicator of our actual life. What we dream depends on what is actually going on in life with us. In that, there's something very interesting, that a lot of people dream of some very specific themes. I'll come back to that in a minute or so. But suffice it to say, there's a lot of research going on the actual dreams which you get when you're asleep. While they are not in our control, they do sometimes give us some disturbance. Sometimes we are relaxed and we are okay with it. We leave it at that. The other is what we call as daydreaming. You know, you're awake, but you go off into a world of your own. So you start daydreaming, you know, how nice it would be if I could go to such and such place, or if I could get a big house, or if I could get something like that. Now, that is what they normally refer to as daydreaming. That means you are in your conscious, woken thought, but you are trying to disconnect yourself from your immediate surrounding, and you are thinking of something which is abstract and which you generally aspire for. Daydreams are generally connected to what you aspire for. The other thing, as I have included in the topic, is fantasizing. So sometimes we want to fantasize about some certain things which mostly do not exist. So we want to, you know, run off into a world of abstraction. There is a subtle difference between daydreaming and fantasizing. Daydreaming, for example, is when you want to aspire, as I said, you want something which may or may not be in your control, but you can aspire for it. A very poor person living in a small hut can daydream and aspire for living in a big bungalow. Or a person who doesn't have very high ideals, very big this thing, may say, at least I want a small house where I can live, you know, happily, my own house, my happy home, and things like that. There have been a lot of songs, Hollywood, Bollywood, Sandalwood, and all, which have spoken a lot about these type of daydreams. One of my favorite ones is a very old song which says, Chota Sa Ghar Hoga. Here is Sonal with the song. Got it. You must have heard so many such songs. Why I played this today specifically was, here is this young man dreaming not of a palace but of a chota sa ghar. And where? Badalon ki chhau mein, in the shadow of clouds. And that is where we will live very happily together. So see how people have daydreams which can be very, very big. Like I said, I want to live in a huge palace. It could be something very small. He need not have sung chota sa ghar hoga. He could have said apna ghar hoga, right? But he says specifically chota sa ghar hoga. What does it mean? It means I'm not greedy. I'm not looking for something flamboyant and something big and all. I'm okay, but I do want the joy of that little cottage of mine under the shadow of clouds, where there is happiness, there is joy, and there is fulfillment. These are the type of dreams which actually keep people moving. In fact, if you remember our late president, Dr. Abdul Kalam, he had one of these proverbs which he used to tell youngsters. His, boost to them used to be dream, dream, dream. He used to tell young people, you should have dreams. You should dream of success. You should dream of happiness. You should dream of achievement. Because only when you have those dreams, they create that positive thinking and that positive feelings in you, which give you the motivation to work and achieve. But there's another very interesting proverb. It says, there's nothing wrong in building castles in the air. Normally they say, no, he is building castles in the air. Meaning to say, he's trying to be stupid. He's trying to build a castle which doesn't exist in the air, right? But there's a proverb which says, build castles in the air and then build a strong foundation below it. So if there is a foundation to hold the castle in the air, it won't collapse, right? Now that is what we need to understand. And that is the reason why I requested Sonal to even play this little song for you, that when you daydream, when you aspire something, is it practical? It may be very difficult, but still, is there an element of that thing being practical? If it does not, then it goes into the world of fantasy. Fantasy is very abstract. Fantasy is something which has no connection to reality. And generally, fantasies do not spur you on to achieve, to work, to strive. They actually take you away from that. So that is the difference I wanted to tell you about dreaming and fantasizing. You dream 10 steps ahead of what you have. You have a house of one room and you say, I want a house of 6 rooms, 10 rooms. It is still a dream. But if you extend your thoughts to thinking about something, I want to have this giant palace on the top of Himalayas where I will have 100 rooms and I will have a retinue of servants. Now you have moved into the world of fantasy. It is no longer a dream. It is no longer an aspiration. And the sad part is that when people start looking into something which is in the realm of fantasy, they actually stop making efforts. That is what we see as counselors, you know, with some of the youngsters. I am a football player. I want to become the world champion in football. And you know the people who are right on top, how much money they make? They make millions of dollars. I want to do that. Okay. Right now, to what level have you reached in football? Yeah, I used to play for my class, and once I was selected for the school team, but I was put in reserve. Now, for the last 2 years, I have not played. So are you in the direction of becoming a star football player? Forget about being the top player. No. So what have you done by dreaming about something like becoming the world champion football player? You have gone into the world of fantasy. And somewhere your subconscious mind dictates to you, telling you that no, it's not possible. You don't admit it to others. But when your subconscious mind tells you that you've hardly been playing, you're not even getting selected for your school team or the neighborhood team. So that means your game can't be all that excellent. When that hits you, you try to escape into the world of fantasy. You don't even make an effort, because you know that if you make that effort and you try to get into that zonal team, and if you're not selected, people will laugh at you. They'll say, what, you wanted to be the world champion and here you're not even getting into the zonal team. So the better thing is not to do it. No, I've got my exams. No, I'm in that particular class. No, I've got this. No, and I'll do that later, and something. They keep giving excuses. So that is what I wanted to warn you about. Let me share with you a very interesting thing that happened when the first lockdown took place in 2020. See, I was a person who has always been interested in traveling. And traveling where? I've never had an ambition to go to USA or Singapore or Switzerland. I want to go to places where there is abundant nature. For example, my most favorite are hill stations. Now, we have innumerable hill stations, in our country, all over the country. Every state has got. One of my nearest and favorite has been Nandi Hills. Nandi Hill is not even 2 hours drive from here. It's just 3,000 feet above. But to me, that's enough. I don't need to go to some Alps in Europe or Himalayas or whatever it is. Okay, now that I have been doing continuously, and more so in summer. Summer is the time when you want to get away to a hill station because the weather is excellent, right? It's so nice, cool, you're surrounded by nature and all that. So in the year 2020, I had already started making plans that where will I go in my summer, to which hill station. And as you know, exactly in March, the lockdown came. Forget about hill station. You can't even, go to the park in your neighborhood. You're locked up at home. Okay, fine. What do you do? It was an amazing coincidence, or whatever you want to call it. I started browsing all the books in our library because I remembered that there is a book which I had read long back, which is 100 Hill Stations of India. It's a picture book. Every hill station has about 2 or 3 pages devoted to it, with 2, 3, 4 photographs. 100 hill stations, right? So you know what I started doing? I started reading about one hill station every night. The last thing before going to sleep, I would put a bookmark and start reading about that. So where is it located? How do you reach there? What are the temperatures? What is the type of accommodation? What is the sightseeing available? Just 2, 3 pages. It would take me a few minutes and I would end my day with that. All this negativity of the whole day being locked up, uncertainty, people getting sick, people dying, whatever was happening at that time, the pressure of that reduced and I would sleep peacefully. And that went on for exactly 100 days. The entire summer passed off. By the time slowly they were started opening out, we could, you know, go out at least within our city, and all these things started off. But those 100 nights were beautiful, because every night I would dream of going to a new hill station. So I'm giving you an example of how your dreams need not cost you big money, need not be something very fantastic and very high flown. It can be something which is very, very simple. At the practical level, as I told you, I love going to any of the nearby hill stations which are motorable distance. Doesn't take too much of traveling or costs. Go, spend some time, come back. But during those days of the lockdown, which, as you know, were extremely bad in terms of movement particularly, I could thoroughly enjoy myself. So this is what I tell people. Dream. Now, in that, I've also done something. I have marked out those hill stations which I would like to go to. And I've already started. I've gone to a few of them. I have it in my, what do you call it, bucket list. That as many of those which I have specifically marked out, I'm going to attend when I get an opportunity. Leaving that aside, we come back to what I was telling you about fantasizing. Now, if I fantasize that I will be the owner of a beautiful island, which will be away from all the countries, I will be not only the owner, but I will be the king of that island. I will have all my subjects. I will have this. I will have a huge ship. I will have aeroplanes to fly me wherever I want to go. That is fantasy. And the interesting thing is that we start off fantasizing when we are children. All of us have done it. Some remember, some don't. That when I was a child, whenever I find things are not going okay according to what I want, what I would do is to start going away into a world of fantasy. Mommy or daddy scolds me. You're not studying well, you're not doing this, you're not doing that, and all. I get angry. I can't answer back, I can't be disobedient or rude to them. So after that shouting is done, I go into my room and I start fantasizing. I look at the roof and I say, why can't I cut a hole in this? Call for a helicopter. They will let down one ladder. I will climb up that ladder and go into the helicopter. That helicopter will take me to my favorite aunt in Chennai, who always has lovely goodies for me whenever I visit her house. So I will go there. I will ask her to make these snacks or sweets for me. I will enjoy myself there, and I will come back and I will close the roof and I will sit down quietly pretending that I have been reading. Now that is how fantasies start in childhood. Most of us outgrow that. Some of us don't. Some of us still want to live in a fantasy world. And that is why we refer to them as childish. Here is this student who is barely scoring 40-50% marks with difficulty. But he says, I want to become an IAS officer. I want to become the prime minister of the country. I want to do this. I want to do that. I want to become a big multimillionaire. When this person starts talking like that, he is going into a world of fantasy. And when the person starts going into the world of fantasy, as he or she grows up, he starts getting detached from reality. On the other hand, if the person says, okay, even if I can't do something very great like becoming a multimillionaire, I will at least have my own business. I will be independent. I don't want to work for others. I want to strive for the day when I will have my own business. I may have 3 employees. I may be doing a turnover of 5 lakhs, doesn't matter. But I will have that satisfaction and I will dream about it. Now that is something which spurs you on, which actually motivates you to start moving in that direction. As I have been saying time and again, always have very lofty long-term goals, but back them up with very realistic short-term goals. So your long-term goals are your dreams. One day I want to change the education system and I want to have an educational institution of my own where children will not be scared of exams and this and that. Children will get true learning and education. That's my long-term goal. I don't know how long it will take me. I don't know whether I will ever achieve that, but I will back it up with short-term goals. Maybe I will give tuition to two or three small children in my neighborhood to take them away from this world of marks and pressures and this and that. I'll actually teach them the application of knowledge. I'll show them how history can be useful, maths can be useful, something else can be useful. When I start doing that, I am setting short-term goals which are taking me one step towards my long-term goal. Every one of my short-term goals should take me. And that long-term goal should be a dream. I have this dream. In fact, I don't know, many of you may not recollect, in the 1960s, there was a leader of the black or the Negro Americans, Martin Luther King Jr. He was a great follower of Mahatma Gandhi and nonviolence and all that. He would start every one of his speeches with the sentence, "I have a dream," he used to say. And then he would elaborate on that. "I have a dream that black people will no longer be discriminated. I have a dream that my children will sit in the same restaurants or the same buses along with the white children. I have a dream that my children or the young generation will rise up to the highest positions in the United States." And he used to follow that up by exhorting his people, his followers, to follow Gandhiji's path of nonviolence, but to be determined and work for it. Take a simple example, like, you know, in those days, Negroes, black people, were not allowed to, you know, sit on particular seats in buses. There was this lady, a Negro black lady, who went and sat on a seat which was vacant. And this very haughty white man came and said, "Get up, get out from here. There are other seats available." She said, "You can sit wherever you want." He said, "No, you can't sit here." The conductor sided by him. She refused. Finally, they stopped the bus at a police station and the police dragged her off the bus. And she said, "Tomorrow again, I'm going to go and sit on that seat." Nonviolence. Satyagraha. She started doing it every day, and every day she was getting pulled out by the police. And that led to a movement which eventually took away this discrimination. The seats which were banned for black people were thrown open. And of course, the greatest thing I wish, you know, our man Martin Luther King had lived to see the day a black man became the president of the United States, Barack Obama, which in the 1960s was beyond comprehension. It was a very wild dream. But since the Constitution did not prevent a black man from becoming president, eventually, 4 decades after Martin Luther King died, a black man did occupy the White House. So this is what primarily dreams are all about. I think the question that I raised up for today's topic was, should adults dream and fantasize? My answer in one word is yes. Don't let go of your dreams. Don't think that dreams are only for children. Don't think that it is childish, you know, to dream of having something big or for achieving something. It actually is a wonderful gift that has been given to us by nature. This brain of ours is perfectly capable of taking you far ahead into the future, taking you into a world which today does not exist. But nothing prevents you from working towards it. Goals, as I say, should not be specific. They should be process goals. I will keep moving in that direction. I will keep constantly improving. I will keep, you know, bringing about changes which are taking me towards a better quality of life. And one of the ways to do it or to reinforce it, one of the tools is to dream. If you do this type of dreaming, you sit down, let your thoughts wander anywhere. Make sure that, you know, you are not among people who will disturb you. And of course, make sure your mobile phone is not there next to you. And then start dreaming. Whatever comes to your mind, in whatever area, there is so much to dream about. There's so much to visualize. There's so much to think. Visualization is an amazing tool. I use it even in our camps that we have in our Manthan retreat. I generally start the day with what we call as creative visualization. That's another way of, you know, making your dreams more vivid and more visual. Close your eyes and start dreaming, I tell the participants, on different themes, whatever is the particular theme of that particular day. I tell, take them into that and start, you know, dreaming about something different. It could be something as simple as getting up from there, floating into the air, flying far away, and going and meeting somebody whom you really love, who is not with you, who is far away from you, who may no longer even be in this world, doesn't matter. Because when you are dreaming, when you are allowing your thoughts to become abstract with no fetters and no restrictions, you can even go and meet somebody whom you love, who is no longer in this world. Even that is possible because of your dreams. So the pain, the loss of somebody who is no longer with you, for whatever the reason, you can overcome that in your dreams. Dreams can remove all barriers and all restrictions. Even people who are aspiring to go to the top in Olympics or in games, they are taught by sports psychologists to dream. Military people are taught to dream that we are going to win this war. Visualize what will happen when we crush the enemy and we win the war. That's how it goes. It's got tremendous therapeutic value. It's got tremendous value towards taking you to one step towards your goals, reducing your immediate stress levels. Do make it a habit to practice it whenever possible, to whatever extent possible. And don't think of it as childish. It is childlike, but not childish. So with that message, can I take a minute's break? And I'll be back with you.
Good morning, all. Nice to see you. So this time it's a change. Instead of Sonal, I'm there here. I thought I will interact because I'm always there behind, you know, with the PPTs or other things. Yeah, so we have a good topic today for the weekend also next. So he's speaking about dream and fantasy. Fantasizing, yeah. So nice to see all of them. Akhila has joined, Asha, Lakshmi. I can see Asha's messages. Good to see that. Yeah, before we start the next session of question and answering, please do start typing your questions. Our old friends, Vinita, Jayashri, good morning to all of you. Okay, so as you all know, I'm there here in the office. Every day, Monday to Saturday, we are doing lots of free counseling happening. And now we have many students coming in for aptitude tests to know their careers. And, you know, lots of career counseling happening here in the academy. The counseling, free counseling also has started. And we have come up with our CPCS, or which we call as communication and presentation skills, with our DCS. Diploma in counseling skills, where the registrations have started this time little early, so nobody misses their seat. Anybody who is interested or who could benefit from this DCS course, kindly do share our office numbers so that, you know, they can also get benefited, like all our old friends. I'm so happy to see so many of them remember and all are sending me hello messages. Good morning, Jayati, Dharnish, Shamla, Neha, Akhila again, and Shobha. Nice to see your messages also here. Please do drop into the office. Let us all, you know, meet, have a get together here. It's long time you people have not come here. Yeah, so back again. Yes, we have started with our DCS admissions. So anybody who could get benefited from this, please do refer them to the academy. Apart from DCS also, we have so many activities happening here in the academy. You know, with our online courses or, you know, the aptitude testing which is going on. So many students have got benefited, and I'm happy to, you know, see that the students who had taken up the test very, very long back, I can see their children coming back for the aptitude test now. So good to see them also there. Yeah, so I hope you all are enjoying today's topic, thinking. And then you can start typing your questions now so that Dr. Ali also can start answering them there. Over to sir now.
Before I start answering your comments and your questions, I just wanted to tell you, as I told you in the beginning, that surveys have shown that most of the most common dreams that people have, one is of being attacked or chased by somebody. It could be an animal, it could be a human being, it could be a stranger. But a lot of us have on and off dreams that somebody is chasing me or somebody is attacking me. The other area of very common dreams is of being late. I have to reach somewhere and I am stuck and I am late and I'm not able to reach the thing. A third area is of loved ones dying. Some of my loved one, you know, is dying or is dead or something like that. The other one is of falling. I'm falling from somewhere, from a height, and I don't know what will happen to me and all this thing. It is also about flying. And it goes back. Often you have dreams about your childhood or your school or it could be sex related dreams. So surveys have shown that these are the most common topics on which we have repetitive dreams. Anyway, that is as far as sleeping dreams are concerned. Today, as I said, I'm focusing more on the dreams which you have or which you build up when you are alive. So now let's see what are the interesting comments. We will start with Akila. It's beautiful to visualize. I love it. As it helps in my writing, I direct my students to visualize as it brings out creativity. Fantastic, Akila. I wish every teacher, regardless of what age group of children you are teaching, I wish every teacher would spend just a few minutes with their children, helping them to visualize. It could even bring down things like exam stress. A lot of children are, this is the time of the year when children are giving their exams. If a teacher, a parent, or whatever the adult can help a child to visualize, to dream that when the result is coming, I am doing this. This is what was done long back, 60, 70 years back by that great, world boxing champion called Muhammad Ali. He used to go on and on and on saying, I am the greatest. I will win every championship. I will defeat every opponent. Hundreds of times he used to repeat it. When he used to meet people, he used to tell them, I am Muhammad Ali and I'm going to be in this championship and I'm going to win this championship. People used to say, what an arrogant and a boastful fellow. But that is what gave him that power, that motivation, that empowerment to reach whatever goals he finally reached, right? Asha says, you brought back old memories. Yes, I'm sure if you are the type of person who can, visualize, who have not given up your inner child, whatever we have been talking about so far will definitely take you into the old memories. In fact, I request you, can you jot down what were these old memories which fleetingly came to you as I was talking in the first half of this program? Just make a note. And next time you get some free time, when you are sitting, alone, when you are without your mobile, start recalling that. Those old memories, the good ones. It could be, as I said, a loved one who's no more there. Or it could be what equations you had in your childhood. It could be about travel. Please remember that when you go out, travel and come back, the memories remain with you for a very long time. And if you keep reviving those memories, it's like every year going back to the same vacation spot. So keep doing that. Jayati says, Ali's write-ups are so energetic and motivational. Jayati, I'm not sir, no, I'm only Ali. Okay. But I'm glad that you do read the write-ups, because I really lament that the number of people who are doing reading is constantly coming down. So those of you who still read, whether it's my write-up, whether it is anything, that doesn't matter. There's so much variety to read. And remember, reading also takes you into a world of dreams and, visualization and things like that. Right now, I'm reading an amazing biography of a person called Samuel Stokes, who was an American, came to India to do some missionary work, eventually converted to Hinduism and renamed himself as Satyanand Stokes. And he did wonders in the hill area of Shimla. They say that the apple orchards that are blooming today and providing wonderful income to all the planters there are a brainchild of Mr. Stokes. Now, it takes me into a different world 100 years back, what this man did, what his struggles were and what he achieved. So that is why I always recommend, please read and read nonfiction. Yes. Asha says, so your talk reminds me of the movie Shaolin Soccer with a coach to teach us like-minded. We can sure build a school that you have described. Definitely you can. In fact, since you mentioned unusual schools, those of you are interested, please read a book called Toto Chan, T-O-T-O-C-H-A-N. Toto Chan is the name of a small girl who gets thrown out from all the schools for indiscipline, finally lands up in a school which is run by a couple, you know, who take in children like these, and they run their school in abandoned railway carriages. They don't have a building. And the way they bring up these children and the way this Toto Chan transformed herself and the way she grew up, the story, it's a real life story from Japan. But this is what helps you to understand what can happen when a person has dreams and works towards fulfilling those dreams. Surekha says, positive dreaming is about having an adventurous mind and a disciplined eye. Yes, right combination, Surekha. If you can have an adventurous mind and also have an eye for detail to look out and check out, to observe. This is another thing which I recommend when you go on, you know, out of your place. Look around and see. There is so much to observe. Small, small things. There's also that proverb which says, never be too busy to stop and smell the flowers. You see flowers from a distance, you admire them and you push off. Don't be so busy that you cannot go close, smell that flower, and then move on. That is what we do. You know that what we are is based on all our five senses. While we give a lot of importance to the visual, to eyes, we do not give equal importance to the other senses. So hearing something, sit somewhere and just start hearing the different types of sounds, connect them, particularly if you're out in nature. Smells, what are the different types of smells? Taste and touch, the feel of something. It could be the feel of a leaf, it could be the feel of ground, it could be the feel of just about anything. Touch. All these five senses are your inputs. Don't let go of any of them. Keep using all your five senses. And the more you use that, the more your brain is activated and the more active you will be in your later years. Vinita says, yes, Sally, everyone should dream, as you had also said in one of your classes. But we must also work towards it, not just sit and dream. But sometimes, Ali, how do we show young adults the reality too? They sometimes refuse or deny to see it. Agreed, Vinita. We have brought up a lot of young adults in a world of what we call as digital society. We have brought them up in a world of, you know, instant gratification. It is our fault. It is not their fault, mind you. It's the fault of the seniors who have encouraged these children to do this rather than taking them out in nature and helping them to show, see that nature takes its own course of time. You may be the richest farmer, but your crop will not ripen one day before the poorest farmer's crop. A crop to ripen takes so many days and you have to wait for that many days. That is how things have to be. So somewhere along the line, I do agree that we come across some young adults. I'm not saying all of them, but whenever you do come across, keep putting the seed and see when it germinates. Don't push them. Don't force them. Don't try to convince them. They will not. But show them the advantages of doing this and leave it. Again, when you get an opportunity, show them that advantage, right? Shobha says, we should visualize strongly what we really want. Then definitely we will get it, Ali. Okay. I agree with you that you should visualize very strongly. But as I said, you may or may not get it. So set goals which are process goals and not end goals. So if I say that I want to earn more money, I want to have a better position, I want to have better qualifications, or I want to have a bigger house. But if I set ultimate goals, I want to have a house which costs 10 crores and which has got 7 bedrooms. Even if I'm living in a house which costs 8 crores and has got 6 bedrooms, I'll be an unhappy person. But if my dream is that I want to eventually move to a bigger house, which is comfortable, which has got all the things that I need in it, every step forward makes you feel happy. And yes, it does give you, get the results more often than people who do not dream about them. Chandat says, what does it mean when one gets the same dream over and over again? Over the course of 10 years, it's literally the same dream. Yes, Shadow. See, I started off in the beginning talking about dreams which we have when we are asleep and we have no control over them. Now, research is still going on. There are dream labs and sleep labs in some of the, you know, major hospitals which try to analyze this. But as far as I know, no specific analysis has given exact results about what the, you know, your dreams mean. But they are definitely connected to something which has either happened in the past and is unresolved emotionally, or it is connected to something that you aspire for and you are getting frustrated that you are not achieving. So if you start looking at what are your past issues which are unresolved, and also the issues which you have aspired for, but we have not been able to get, somewhere at least marginally, you will get some connection between the dream and what is happening there. If you start working in your daytime hours, even start working that first step towards a 1,000-mile journey, as they say, if you start moving in that direction, you may find that these dreams, if they are disturbing dreams, they get released. Jayati says, yes, sir, before I used to dream of falling from a height. That's one of the common ones, as I read, but I'm glad that it has got over. That means there was something disturbing you and now you have been able to overcome it. Asha says, I've had dreams when my children are not on the right track. I have been rude to them then, as I was inequipped to handle it. But now I'm able to lift them, just sharing. Thanks for that sharing, Asha. Because it shows that if you have that determination, if you have that will, if you're willing to work towards your dreams, you can achieve to greater or lesser extent. And you learn to enjoy the journey instead of aspiring for the destination. That is what makes life beautiful. Jayati says, also, I used to dream, next day I have exam and I don't know anything. Immediately fear gripped and I used to open my eyes. This continued for many years. But after I did elaborate courses from Banjara, these dreams just stopped. Exactly. When you started looking, no, Jayati, towards the bigger picture of life, you found that even if there's an exam for which you are ill-prepared, it's not the end of the world. So you start looking beyond that little thing, because otherwise what happens as children? It is drilled into us that exams are the ultimate and everything, as though exams determine your life, which they don't. But that gets ingrained so much in our subconscious mind that they start becoming part of your dreams. So when you go through this process, like a DCS or anything for that matter, it could be something that you do by yourself, it could be, you know, things like mindfulness, it could be spirituality. Whatever you take up, it will definitely help you to overcome these disturbing dreams. Shika says, positive self-talk. That's the best fantasy, becomes real because you have bluffed, hoodwinked your brain enough and you actually start believing and work towards it. Excellent thought, Shika. And you recollect, as children, most of us had imaginary friends. We used to actually give a description and a name to that friend. And we used to talk to that friend. We used to, you know, have discussions with that friend. And it used to make us feel so nice that I have this friend with whom I can share whatever I want. And he or she responds to me, supports me, and things like that. The same thing happens in adult life. Talk it out. Sit alone and start talking. That is one way of, you know, converting your dream, your aspiration into something. And that's why I told you about the five senses. So it's, you don't need to actually sit in front of a screen and watch. In fact, I am one person who cautions people against usage, too much usage of the screen. Because remember that whether it's a TV, whether it is Netflix, whether it is YouTube, these are all one-way communication. But the real growth happens if there is a two-way communication. So that happens only if you're sitting with a friend or you're sitting alone and talking to yourself. It works. Ah, Dr. Dagnish, I always welcome him to this program. Despite a very busy schedule, he looks after a primary health center. But whenever Dagnish comes online, I feel very happy. Dagnish, thanks for being there. And Dagnish's point is, Ali, is there any role of dreaming and fantasizing with respect to relationships? Yes, it does. Only thing is, as I told you, fantasizing about some things. Let's say a child does not have a very loving, caring father. And the child starts fantasizing about having somebody else as a father who will do great things and all that. Now, you know that that's not practical, that is not real. So what happens? That takes you away from that relationship. You stop making efforts towards improving your relationship with your father, your spouse, your best friend, whoever it may be. But if you dream about it, that I want to work on it, it does help improve relationships. Shamla says, I was under the impression that why go back and recall the moments? It may be good or bad events. It has already happened and gone. Just be in the present and do what best I can do now. How it will help to go back and recall? Yes, Shamla, as I was explaining a little while back also, there are unresolved issues, both positive and negative. Recalling something positive. I had gone to this beautiful resort and I had spent so many days there and I had the best of company of my nearest and dearest of friends. And I have such good memories. Why not recall those memories? You can't afford to keep going back to that resort every now and then. But in your daydreams, in your visualization, you can go back and that creates that positive energy. The reverse of that, I had a bad experience. I suffered. With great difficulty, I came out of it. Let me go back and, you know, review that to make sure that it is still not hurting me. If I run away from that, that means there's something wrong. If I say, no, I don't want to think about it. I don't want to talk about it. I don't want to go into the past. That means it is unresolved. That means you need to do something about it. Farida says, how about dreams of snakes, multiple snakes? Yes. As I was telling you, something which is, you know, chasing you, something which is hurting you, something which is threatening you. These are very common dreams. So in this particular case of Farida, it could have been snakes because somewhere in your subconscious mind, you are scared of snakes. You may not even discuss it. You may not even think actively about it. But it is possible that, you know, you have read some stories about snakes, you watch some movies, you know, those stupid movies are there where that woman turns into a snake and then she goes and chases people and something like that. So those things have embedded themselves into your, you know, subconscious mind. And when there is something disturbing, it takes the form in your dream, it takes the form of snakes. You don't have to worry about snakes or anything. It's not that there are actual snakes chasing you. But you need to be aware of the fact that there are certain fears which are embedded into me, which I have not been able to overcome. So at a practical level, what is it that I am afraid of? I may be afraid of failure. I may be afraid of some relationship. I may be afraid of financial loss. So work on that and you see those snakes will happily go away into the jungle and they won't bother you. Ashwini says, hi Ali, dreaming and speaking loudly in dream sometimes reveals the past, which is very secret and causes problems. Yes, Ash, I agree with you that, but as you know, these dreams are not in your control. The very fact that you dreamt of something which was a secret or which was something not very pleasant, and while dreaming about it, you started talking about it. You know what is that factor? That it has become so somatic. Soma is the body, psych is the mind. It has become so psychosomatic that your body does not, you know, be assured by just going through that process in the dream. You actually start speaking it out. So this is a warning signal to you that something in the past, which was very personal, very secret, or very unpleasant, and had not been resolved, it is taking, not only it's taking a form of a dream which is hurting you, but which is actually making you talk in your sleep. So you go ahead and please resolve those past memories. However past it is, you may say that happened 3 years back or 30 years back, it doesn't matter. This speaking about something unpleasant in your sleep is a very clear indicator that you need to resolve it. There are different ways and means of doing it, as I keep reminding you. Select whichever is the best for you. Karthik says, sometimes do you think dreams might guide what may happen in future? Now, this is a very fascinating question. There are people who say, I dreamt about the death of somebody known to me. I dreamt about this, I dreamt about that, and it happened. To the best of my knowledge, nothing has been proven so far that dreams can forecast the future. But what your dream may actually be indicating is your fears. So you love somebody, you may have a very elderly person, or you may have a sick person or something like that. And you find that that person you love so much, and you are scared that that person may die, or something, some harm may happen to that person. So since it is embedded in your subconscious mind, it comes in your dreams also. And it may so happen that because that person was sick or infirm or very old or whatever, that person may actually pass away, and we immediately connect to that. But don't get misled by all these things. So far, nothing has been proven, right? Akila says, I do agree with you, Ali. When I was in my teens, I used to get dreams of snakes. These dreams disappeared when certain issues were resolved. Here is a clear-cut, concrete example of what I am saying. There are so many people like Akila who will bear testimony to the fact that you resolve the issues and things do get, you know, worked out on their own. It's a continuous process. Whatever topic I have been taking up every Saturday and discussing with you all has got something or the other to do with reality, which can be resolved. You don't have to give up saying that, oh, I'm going through such a bad thing, I don't think I can come out of it. Don't surrender. Work on that thing. Resolve whatever the things are. Navina says, clairvoyant person may be able to see things of future, but it's virtue gifted by God. Yes, we do hear of clairvoyants, we do hear of people who predict the future and all that. I have not gone deep into it, so I'm not an expert. I don't want to comment on their abilities or their realities or whatever it is. But in general, let us understand that you and I, what we call as the common people, cannot predict the future through our dreams. If a dream comes, it is only our anxiety, our worry, or our deep emotions which are getting expressed in that form. Asha said, I had dreamt of my father circumventing me on his bicycle twice and moving towards the horizon. A week later, he passed away. Yes, these are all indicators. Supposing he had not passed away, that dream would not have had any meaning. We get 100 dreams. Out of that, one of them happens, that your father actually passes away, and then you connect to that. But don't get carried away, don't get disturbed. In fact, it will make your life even more miserable. Enjoy yourself, have a wonderful weekend, and as usual, we shall meet next Saturday at 11 o'clock, and we are going to be talking about, is it good to be sensitive? Some of us are really sensitive, no? Is it a good trait that, yes, because I'm sensitive, I understand others and I do things? Or is it that by being sensitive, I'm spoiling my life and becoming too disturbed? We will look at both the angles next Saturday, which is on 4th of March at 11 o'clock. See you. Bye-bye.